was a famous trumpet man from old Chicago way. He had a boogie style that no one else could play. He was a top man at his craft. But then his number came up and he was gone with the draft. He's in the army now, a blowin' reveille. He's the boogie woogie bugle boy of Company B. They made him blow a bugle for his Uncle Sam. It really brought him down because he couldn't jam. The captain seemed to...
A shell went off and I got a little piece of shrapnel in my arm.
When he plays reveille, he's the boogie woogie bugle boy of Company B.
And I went over to the medic's tent. And it was horrible in there. People's legs laying around. And this doctor came up to me and said, "What could I do for you?" I said, "Nothing." I just walked on. Yeah, if I'd have wrote my name down, I'd have got a Purple Heart probably.
Plays boogie boogie bugle, he was busy as a buzz bee. And when he plays, he makes the company jump A to the bar. He's a boogie boogie bugle boy of Company B.
Newsflash: North Korea Reds declare war, invade South by land and sea.
On June 25th, 1950, the ongoing conflict between North and South Korea escalated to war. North Korea's invasion of South Korea invoked what the United Nations referred to as a police action. Within days, expansive military operations were carried out by the United States against North Korea. The war would last more than 3 years, killing and wounding an estimated 2.5 million soldiers and civilians. This is the story of one soldier who survived. These are his personal views on the war, race, politics, and the future of the United States.
Tell them how you decided to join the army. You met your friend in the park.
Yeah, we was down there drinking beer every day in the park. This old car pulled up, and it was a friend of mine, you know. I hadn't seen him in years, and he had a uniform on with the first cavalry patch. I said, "Hey, that's pretty sharp looking." He said, "Yeah." So anyway, we went on drinking beer, and this mean guy, he was a three-time loser, he said, "Let's go down and join the army." I said, "Okay." They took me and turned him down.
In 1976, when I was 13 years old, there was a man that lived in that house. Everyone in the neighborhood referred to him as Crazy Bill. At the time, I was in a relentless pursuit of his daughter, Karen. She was the most beautiful girl I had ever laid eyes on. Everyone on the block told me I was insane to go after Crazy Bill's daughter. So perhaps I was the crazy one. But this story isn't about me. It's about a man they called Crazy Bill. This story, his views, his opinions on war, politics, race, and religion, and the everlasting effects of an abused and neglected child, and what led to a very tragic and bitter life.
Would you do it all over again?
No.
No?
For this country? I got no use for the country. It's gone to hell. The socialists have taken over, give everything away, and we're going broke. We're already broke. We ain't got no money. We owe China $17 billion. And Obama's gonna borrow another couple of billion. Your kids and grandkids will be paying that back. There's no future here. No, I wouldn't do it again. I remember a sergeant brought this young black kid up to me. He said, "Show him how to shoot the machine gun." I said, "Okay." So found on and set behind a rock. And it was a BAR, 30 caliber. And I said, just shoot at that rock down there. That was the first one I'd seen.
Did you turn out to like the guy? Was he a nice guy?
Hey, young kid, just like us. I don't know whatever happened to him either.
So you personally don't have anything against black people?
Well, we don't need a nigger president. The American people voted him in. They ought to have known that the Democrats would play the racist card on Fox News. Every one of those senators and that get on there and talk, they play the race card. You don't like Obama because he's the black. You can't trust a Chinaman. He'll smile at you. You ask him a question when you're interrogating, he just smiles at you. My buddy Roscoe, he's mean. He turned around, the goof was smiling at him. He told the interpreter, ask him what he's smiling about. So we asked him, he said he didn't know. Roscoe just took that M1 rifle right in the face. When I got on the ship in Korea to go back to Japan, they gave us all one of them.
Okay.
And I was on the ship standing there looking at the water, and this little young sailor come up and says, hi. I said, how you doing? And he says, what's that medal you got there? And I said, I don't know. They gave us all one. He said, well, we didn't get no medals. I said, well, you didn't do nothing. Float around on a fucking ship. And I said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll give it to you. I just took it off and gave it to him.
So did our troops leave Korea when it was over? Everyone was out of there?
We're still there.
We're still there today?
We still got 50,000 troops on the 38th parallel. That's the line that divides North Korea from South Korea. Now in June 1950, North Korean troops came across that line, and it's only an hour to Seoul, their capital, South Korea. And that's when we went over there. Mm. And we annihilated their army. And then Red China come in. All we do is let them build our stuff. I don't get this country. Egypt hates our guts, and we're giving them $2 million a year. I don't get it. I don't understand. Fox News don't understand either. But I'll say one thing. This country should have known not to put a nigger in the White House.
Did he just use the N-word again for the second time in less than a minute? He uses it so indiscriminately, but why am I not surprised? After all, this is a documentary, and the whole point of a documentary is to let a person tell the story in their own words. But using a word like that simply is not socially acceptable in any context, in my opinion. The history of how we arrived at this point when a person calls an African American the N-word is a highly debated issue and extremely complex. Did Crazy Bill always have this attitude toward African Americans? What drives a man to use such harmful and hateful language so openly and outwardly? Leonard Owen Alexander was born April 22nd, 1930, in St. Louis, Missouri. At the age of 4, his mother, Genevieve, pictured here in the center, died during a botched abortion. This headstone marks her gravesite in St. Louis, Missouri. Shortly thereafter, his father, pictured here with Genevieve, abandoned him at the age of 8. It wasn't that long before Bill started getting into serious trouble. At the age of 9, while hanging around the wrong people, Bill was running numbers for a group of gamblers in the St. Louis area. One day, while hanging out with a group of men at a local gas station, a gasoline can was inadvertently kicked over, which ignited a fire in which several people died. Although nobody was ever charged, and the facts surrounding the case remain a mystery to this day, the state's welfare department for children recommended to a judge that Bill be sent to reform school. He would remain there till the age of 13.
We may go bankrupt this year. The country. That means that puts 1929 to shame. That was the big depression.
So you think we could go through another depression?
Yes.
Why are you Republican when you have no money?
Because I'll tell you what. Those people worked hard for their money. The people with money. They worked hard all their lives. They wasn't a fucking liberal bum, you know, that sits there and give me a food stamp. That's the only reason he got elected. He promised them more entitlements, you know? We don't need that. Let them go out and pick up cans or do something. You know how much money we give in food stamps a year? Horrible.
Did you see on the news that Dennis Rodman, the basketball player, went over to see that?
Yeah,
Kim Jong-il.
Yeah. What do you think that was all about?
I don't know.
All right, Mom, thank you.
He's a nigger.
Yeah.
That's self-explanatory right there.
So why should people just go out and pick up cans when they're better off on food stamps?
What if you had the Republicans in there? They'd cut those fucking food stamps in half. And them niggers that have to go to work down there. You know, and those Mexicans. And that's why the Democratic Party, they'll probably win again the election next time. Because they give everything, entitlements. Nobody ever gave me nothing.
As Bill continued down a path filled with racism, bitterness, and self-loathing, I started to piece together where all of the hatred and frustration may have been coming from. These old home movies of his family show us what it must have been like to grow up in middle-class America during the early 1960s. This old footage shows us a typical American family celebrating the holidays as many of us do each year. What it doesn't show you is the tragic loss Bill would suffer after leaving the military. Bill would lose 3 of his 6 children, 2 of which died very early in life. Skip, shown here at the tender age of 7, would die from VSD, or ventricular septal defect, sometimes referred to as a hole in the heart. His first daughter, Debbie, had also previously passed away from a high fever at the age of 1. And finally, in yet another tragic twist of fate, Bill's eldest son, Larry, shown here on the left, would die the same day as his cousin, Lyle, shown here, running in the park with Larry.
And when he came home, they put a year extension on him. He was going to have to stay in another year.
And I did stay in for a while. I was supposed to come home and get discharged.
Did they make you stay, or?
Yes.
I was on a Greyhound bus leaving St. Louis. There was a coffee stop right out on the highway. And I heard all these soldiers cussing and all that. There was a newspaper rack. It said Truman adds 1 year extension. And I think I served about 6 months of it, and then I got out.
Shortly after returning home from the war, Bill and his wife Patricia were celebrating at the Zebra Lounge in Los Angeles, California. On their way home, they crashed into the back of a big rig that had stalled out and parked in the middle of the road. Their injuries were so severe, it would take them a year to recover. Due to Bill's injuries and the fact that he could no longer work, he was laid off from his job at Rockwell International, who at the time was the largest defense contractor for the United States government. The very same government he had laid his life on the line for just a few years earlier.
Bill, what do you think of Obamacare?
Oh, horrible. All it is one big tax. And he lied when he wrote the thing out. 2,400 pages. I saw him on television. He said, if you like your insurance, you can keep your insurance. If you like your doctor, you can keep your doctor. Then it shows another skit.
On the news, an anchor woman called him a liar.
Was she fired?
Well, he is a liar.
What happened to her?
Nothing. She was on last night.
She
called him a liar.
What channel?
40. Fox News.
Oh, yeah, you can get away with it there.
Fair and balance.
Here. You straighten this out.
Do you think Fox News is fair and balanced?
Yes, yeah. They tell the truth.
Yes, they tell the truth.
You think so, Lance?
I do.
CNN's liberal. They're Democrats.
So they're liars?
They're liars.
Do you think if there's a Republican president nominated next time, he'll increase the war budget or decrease it?
Increase it.
He'll increase it. Obama just decreased it. He's putting one of our biggest carriers in mothballs. And China's building the biggest carrier in the world.
I think Hillary Clinton's gonna get it.
Oh, God. That's liar. Do you
have any other?
The Republicans in there, and they say, tighten your belt, son of a bitches, because the spending is stopping. And it listed yesterday on television some of the things that Obama's paying for. Robotic legs for rabbits means of dollars. You know, that's crap, you know. Giving countries money that hate her guts.
True.
Karzai hates us. He's Afghanistan. He hates our guts. We was going up this hill one day. We didn't take the hill. Another outfit took it. And it was a dead... They hit this Chinese machine gun nest with the flamethrower. And it just burns you to a crisp. And somebody put a cigarette in his mouth. The dead Chinaman. He was still on the gun. Once that napalm hits you, you're done. We was on the way up to the front. That's right after we got off the boat. And our sergeant in the back of the truck told the driver to stop. There was some shelter halves laying on the ground. And he pulled the thing off of the three dead Americans under there. He said, "This could be you." Told the driver, "Let's go."
So do you think the sergeant knew those guys were there? He just wanted to make a point?
I wonder about that.
Okay. You were thinking the same thing? That was to make a point.
Yeah.
That...
We're a bunch of 18-year-olds. An 18-year-old's trigger happy. The older guy, 30, 35, they stop and think. You know, 18-year-old don't stop and think.
What were the living conditions like for you in Korea?
While I was in there?
While you were there.
We had a hell of a winter in 50. All the soldiers were writing home to their mamas, "Get us some coats over here." So pretty soon the army brought officers, big overcoats. It was cold.
Did you have, what were you in, bunkers or tents, or what were you in? Where did you sleep?
Right there in the hole.
Just out in?
Out in the open. Yeah. Funny thing happened. I was off, like I said, I used to go on little walks by myself, you know. I'd sneak up when things weren't going on. And I come up on this little hill, and I seen huts down there, made out of wood. So we made them, or somebody. So I went down there, and they were locked, padlocks on them. And I shot this lock off, and I went in there, and the Russian uniforms hang in there. Pretty soon I felt something tap me on the shoulder, and I turn around. I guess he's an American. I don't know who the fuck he was. He told me, he says, "Now what you just seen, don't you ever repeat it." He said, "Go back to your outfit and forget this." I was at Fort Leonard Wood, and the day come I was supposed to get discharged, and the lieutenant called me in his office, and he said, "I got your discharge here." He says, "I have to ask you, I know you're gonna say no." He said, do you wanna reenlist? You got $10,000 if you reenlisted." And I says, he says, "I can't promise you that you won't go back to Korea. You know, if things get tough again over there, you can go back." I said, "I'll set this one out."
United States Army, a grateful nation. Please accept this flag as a symbol of appreciation for your loved ones' honorable and faithful service.
In 1976, when I was 13 years old, there was a man that lived in that house. Everyone in the neighborhood referred to him as Crazy Bill. At the time, I was in a relentless pursuit of his daughter, Karen, and it worked. Karen and I have experienced a profound love that we can only wish others are as fortunate to have. On June 23rd, 2015, we celebrated our 30th wedding anniversary, and we have never been happier. When we were younger, nobody understood why Bill was the way he was, or why he said the things he said. The notion that one can understand or comprehend what another man's gone through without walking in his shoes is preposterous. I never knew why people called him Crazy Bill, but in hindsight, it doesn't matter. Bill and Pat's three surviving children went on to lead very good lives and have all raised children of their own, including the son Karen and I had together, our son Brock. They say misery loves company, but Bill was the exact opposite of that. He did not want to cast any of his misery upon anyone, so he pushed people away with anger, harsh words, and bitterness, and for that they called him crazy. He never explained himself to me, or anyone else for that matter. He didn't have to. We just accepted him the way he was. That's why we should never judge anyone in this life, and always keep an open mind to the very, very end. We simply choose to
I take for granted that you're always there.
If you had two words to say to the Queen, what would they be?
Fuck you.